The abstract is titled Language and Thought. There are two popular approaches in philosophy of language. They are meaning-oriented and language-oriented. For the former, language is reference, representation, or designation, and for the latter, it is presentation or expression. There are grossly two theories about the relation of language and thought. They are separate and independent, and second, that they are infused or non-different. The dichotomies of indeterminate and determinate cognition, its verity, and the question of validity, synthetic and analytic, are more than the problem of identical cognition by language, cannot be solved reasonably by any argument if the problem of nature and relation between the language and thought are not well observed and settled. Difference of language and meaning in thought is acceptable to those who take the language and thought and the laws of language and that of thought as different. Western and Indian schools of philosophy, other than the Paninian grammarian, take only the meaning as thought and make a difference between the two by taking language only as a referencing tool for representation of the thought. For the theory discussed herein, language is thought or concept. All words are concepts, and the concept for us is not static and given in the mind. Mind is not a storehouse of concepts. Concepts is that the mind flash, and the mind is not a producing company that produces thoughts through the sensory data. Mind is self-consciousness, and the concepts are its flashing. Mind is naturally fit only for flashing. We know memory objects when they flash and when all flashings appear in the present moment. Past and future events are also known thus when the mind flashes them so. All flashes are determined and veridical that serves as a cognitive ground of validity and invalidity of the statements on the basis of availability and non-availability of reference in the empirical world. If language and thought are different and the meaning is transcendental to language, then as Jacques Derrida observes, the analysis and translation of language separate from thought will not be the analysis and translation of the thought. It will be difficult to accept philosophy as a system of analysis of language for the clarification of thought, and hence analysis will be an aimless game and translation will be just an approximation or a guess. If language and thought are taken as different, how can the clarification of the latter by analysis of the former be achieved? Not only analysis, but philosophy will also be a useful task if language and thought are taken to be separate. It is rather putting the cart in the track of philosophy to assume language and thought as different on one hand, and to accept analysis of language as the basis of the clarification of thought on the other hand. This difficulty is equally applicable to those philosophies which take language as confined to language token or garb, and also to those who take language as abstracted from the verbal utterances or the written script. For the autonomy theory, the same idea from the point of view of expressibility is language, and from the point of view of that which is expressed by it is the meaning. Language is concept or thought object infused by language. The idea of infusion of language and thought or cognition serves as the ground of philosophical activities as cognitive activity par excellence. I request Siddharth to please take the dais now.
I would like to humbly call you upon the dais for formally welcoming our speaker for today, Professor D. N. Tiwari.
Okay, thank you, Siddharth. Thank you so much, Siddharth and Ilika, doing well on the dais, and it's pleasant to see that scholars are taking this event seriously. First of all, in delivering formal vote of thanks, I would like to thank you, Professor D.N. Tiwari, for accepting my invitation for delivering this lecture. And it is a fact that he is a well-known throughout not only in India but abroad also through his publications and the way he expresses ideas. He is going to deliver today about the relationship between language and reality in Indian context as well as in Western context. This is a very happy moment for all of us to listen to him. So I welcome him, Professor D.N. Tiwari sir, and I welcome everybody related to this Saturday seminar event, which is going now very well on each Saturdays. I welcome all the scholars from Department of Philosophy, University of Lucknow, as well as from all corners of India and abroad. And I wish that it will grow like it has been growing in the future as well. And now I welcome all the teachers as well from this department as well as from other departments of India and all research scholars, all students, everybody associated with this event. With this brief note, with this brief formal note of thanks, I invite Professor D.N. Tiwari sir to deliver his talk and thereafter discuss with us. Professor D.N. Tiwari sir.
Not audible. Sir, we cannot hear you. Sorry.
Sir, unmute yourself, sir.
It's not audible.
Sir, unmute yourself. No, sir. Unmute. You are not audible.
Is it mute?
Yeah, now it is perfect.
Now?
Perfect.
Okay. Yeah. I am audible well?
Yes, sir.
I am audible well?
Audible, visible both, sir.
So, it's very nice to share my views on language and thought with my philosophy friends. And scholars, I'm well aware that most of you are more knowledgeable than me, but I have some views to share with, and I'm thankful to Professor Pandey who gave me an occasion to share my views this afternoon. So the topic he has given to me is language and thought, east and west. So we are human beings. We live at the same time in two worlds. Professor Kanti is here. So the first one is the world of doing with the things, doing. And the second is the world of knowing. So what do I mean with the world of doing? And how it makes a difference in philosophy. And what do I mean when I say that the world of knowing, and when I concentrate on this world of knowing, how I differ from the former perspective. So, you know, when the philosophers or thinkers think about the world of doing, how to interpret it, how to link it with the knowledge, they become more artificial, more logical, and they do not think about, they think about how I can proportionate my knowledge with the things outside which I am perceiving. So the very simple perspective they adopt is that yes, there are things outside, they are sensed by us, and we have a mind. The mind produces knowledge when it acquires senses from the outside. So philosophers, when they concentrate on the world of doings, they become metaphysicians. They think that yes, there are things, whether it is transcendental or it is empirical, outside our knowledge. And the purpose of philosophy is to open the secret of the metaphysical things, whether it is empirical or it is transcendental. Metaphysics is metaphysics. And I don't find any justification to divide metaphysics into the metaphysics of the transcendental and the metaphysics of the empirical. For the purpose of today's discussion, I consider metaphysics as metaphysics, whether it is empirical or transcendental. So when we concentrate on the world of our doing, we perceive the things outside, and they are transcendental to knowledge. Okay, the senses grasp them, but how the senses grasp them? We say that there is a senses, the things outside have the qualities, and the qualities are perceived by the senses. Senses acquire data, and this data the mind changes into the knowledge. So this is how we understand very simply, and we won't have any doubt about that. But philosophers' task is start from here, according to my perception. Because you know, we philosophy people think that we are concerned with a higher knowledge. A higher knowledge means that we concentrate on thoughts, on ideas, on our knowledge. So concentrating on knowledge makes a lot of difference for a philosopher and for a philosophy doing people. How it can does, I will discuss today's lecture. So I have already presented in the abstract that a wrong perception of mind is there based on doing, on the world of doing with the things. That perception is that there is a mind, and there are senses, and senses bring data, and the mind, that is a factory, a faculty that can produce knowledge. But do you think that mind is a producing machine? It can produce knowledge? I doubt. Again, if I say that yes, mind synthesizes the data acquired from the senses, and then it manufactures the knowledge. So mind is not a manufacturing company. And I'm very much sure that this is all a very simple way to understand how my mind proportionate with the things in the matter of knowing. But the correct position, as I perceive, you may disagree, but I perceive is that mind at human level is self-consciousness. Self-consciousness in Indian philosophy, you know, we interpret that there is Annamaya Kosh, Pranamaya Kosh, Manomaya Kosh, and then big Jnanamaya Kosh. That is self-consciousness. So here, all the characters of Annamaya, that is material world, that is vital world, and that is the passions, emotions, and again, self-consciousness emerges at human level. So humans are defined as self-conscious being. And you know, when one becomes a self-consciousness becomes self-consciousness only when it has an idea of an object. Without object, it cannot be self-conscious. It can be, but it cannot know that I am self-consciousness. So mind is a self-consciousness. That means mind is a placing being. All that the senses perceive, all the data we acquire, they help manifesting the mind to flash. But mind is always self-placing being. It flashes knowledge. It does not produce. It does not construct knowledge. It flashes knowledge. So it is a flashing. And it is self-conscious. This means it flashes objects. It flashes objects. So flashing means that, like computer, when you type something, something flashes on the computer scene. Not like that. Here lies the significance of thoughts. So thoughts stands at the object that the mind flashes. Not thoughts are not produced by the mind. Thoughts are the flashes of the mind. Now with this brief introduction of the limitation of the mind, according to me, I will start with language, how the those who believe in the world of doing with the things perceive about the language, and those who believe in the world of knowing, who concentrate on the world of knowing, how they reflect on language. So see, usually those who believe in the world of doing, they think that yes, there is a language, very essential part of our culture, part of our life. No communication can be performed without language. And we use language to represent the things. Language is a reference, language is a representation, language is a designation, and like that we characterize it, we define it according to the functions it performs. So, but if we think that language is confined to only speaking or writing, then we are overlooking the essence of the language. What are sort of essence of the language we are overlooking? The essence of language is that in our Indian thought, what we speak, what we articulate by our mouth, they are called dhvaniya, sounds. They are not language. And what we write, script, that is lipiya, that is not language. So language is that bhasa, that which illuminates thoughts. So this question makes a point that we are condemned to think about concentrating on the world of knowing. So philosophers used to talk about, okay, if there are something, I can proportionate the language and the thought by some conceptualization. Okay, but conceptualization is not possible if there is no concept. There is difference between the concept and the conceptualization. We all have the concept of man. But when we conceptualize, for example, you see, conception of mind in Tagore, conception of mind in Radhakrishnan, conception of mind in Vivekananda, so many conceptions emerges out of conceptualization. But concept is the basic ground that flashes in our mind when the mind is uttered. Yeah, when the thought of the man come into the mind, and then we conceptualize it. So a concept is that which places, and what it places is always in present. Even the past memories, they also flash in present, and then we know. The future predictions, they also flash in present, and then we know. So concepts are always that which flashes in the mind when we communicate with language, with others, or within ourselves. So what is language then? Language is not confined to dhvaniya and lipiya. Language is something like thought, like idea. So if I say that, professor, please write an essay on the article A, so you will write so many pages on only single letter A, that is article. How it is possible? It is possible because A as a concept flashes in my mind, and I analyze that concept and write so many pages on in a simple single article A. Even if and anything, I can write so many pages. Even books, I can write on articles. But how it is possible? Okay, so this means concepts are always, concepts are flashes that flashes always in present. Even the past memories and future predictions are flashes, and only then we know that it is memory and it is prediction. Unless it is flashes, we cannot make a difference that this is distinguished knowledge of, this is flash of the memory, and this is flash of the prediction. This is prediction and this is memory. So, but about conception, we know what metaphysicians conceptualize, and they conceptualize by taking that a concept is a static thing, but concept is not a static thing. Concept is a dynamic thing. It always flashes, and it always flashes in the present. And that's why a self-conscious human beings know the concept, but a philosopher conceptualize also. But we have to make a distinction. We have to distinctly know the difference between the concept and the conceptualization. Now, it is clear that at thought level also there is language. So language is not confined only to lipiya and dhvaniya. At thought level also, unless the thought is expressed, no verbal noises will come out to speak. There is thought to speak, the expectancy to speak, and then the air blows up, and when collided on the top, it comes into the mouth and the vibrations pass out. These vibrations passes in the ear, and then it is transformed by the ears into the language. So if the ears are not correct, suppose my wall of the house has no ear, so it cannot change my vibrations which I articulate outside into the language. But my ears are here, and they are healthy. They can do for receiving and tossing it into and transforming it into language. So the thing is that first the thought of the language will flash in the mind when we articulate something, when we hear something, or when we think about something to speak. So at thought level, we cannot deny the existence of language. But at thought level, it is intelligible being. At speaking level, it is material product we produce through mouth. But at thought level, it is not produced by our mouth or anything else, any instrument of speaking. At thought level, it is flash of our consciousness, self-consciousness, and self-consciousness, it places it and knows that it places it. So there is difference between the object thought and the knowledge of the thought. So what is the difference between the knowledge and the object of knowledge? The difference is that a object of thought can be the object of an other knowledge also. Okay, na? Suppose I have a I have an object of man. Object man. When you say that, do you know what man is? I can say that yes. But this man can be used. This man can be the object of another statement sentence also. But the knowledge is always in present, the knowledge of the man in different occurrences and instances is known as the man because of the knowledge that is never an object. The object of knowledge can be another, but the knowledge of the object of the knowledge can never be another. I think that I'm not making the point complex. So there is otherness in the object of knowledge, but there is no otherness in the knowledge of the object of knowledge. This is the basic difference between the object and the knowledge of the object. Now about now we come to conclude that there is a language at flesh level, and that flesh level is what we know. That is intelligible being. That is intelligible object. The language as intelligible object, that is an idea or thought, or you can say concept that is fresh by the language, by the consciousness, is also involved in our knowing. So when I say language, it comprises our speaking or writing, as well as our the intelligible being of writing or speaking. Am I clear? Hello? Am I clear, na?
Yes, no sir. Responses. Perfect. Everything is perfect. All right, sir. Everything is perfect.
So when I say language, when philosophers use language or reflect on language, for them, language is not only confined to speaking and listening. Not only file and dispatch, but the file and dispatch of the speaking utterances, they serve for manifesting the language as idea, that is intelligible being. So language comprises of the verbal noises or the written marks, signs, symbols, and the intelligible being of language as well. So far the their nature is concerned, the what we write or what we utter, they are material in nature. They can destroy the time moment, and they can they cannot stand again. But what flesh is, it can flesh again. It can flesh again means all fleshings are new, but the object can flesh many times, and with the fleshings, one or the many, the fleshing nature of consciousness does not extinct it, does not destroy it. It is not limited. Fleshing consciousness is not limited to one fleshing or the other. Its nature is fleshing. So it fleshes always the objects. And what it fleshes is intelligible being. So intelligible being is only thought, and for me it is the thought of the language and the thought of the meaning. So our cognition is the cognition of the thought of language and the thought of the meaning. You can say that there are two thoughts, and what is the linking between the two thoughts? I want to make it clear that humans are very self-conscious being. And being self-consciousness, when the thought of language flashes through our utterances, through our dhvaniya, that flesh expresses the meaning. So there is no need of any link, because the thought of the language, that is the intelligible being of language, is quite fit. I can say that it is the fitness of the intelligible being of language that it expresses its meaning non-differently. So there is no need. This fitness of the language, intelligible being of language, that subsides the relation between the intelligible being of the thought. So there is no third link required for linking the language with the thought of meaning. So my what I want to say is that what we listen, it manifests the intelligible being of language first, and then that expresses the intelligible being of meaning. So meaning is not outside. Meaning is what places in my mind by the language. So the philosophy for me is confined only to what places, and the mind has capacity, natural capacity, to place only the language and the meaning. Out things that we experience in our empirical world or our transcendental world, philosophically, they do not enter in our mind and they make aware of us. They are outside and outside. Our knowledge is confined only to what is intelligible objects. And the intelligible objects are all that is expressed by language. And the language is also intelligible being. Now, if I ask a question, let me make the point more clear. If I ask a question, suppose this is mobile. When I say this is mobile, you understand all that this is mobile. Why? Because you can say that it has a length, it has a width, it has a height, it looks like this, having this shape, size, and this material. And that determines the thing mobile. But these are the things, these are the qualities of the objects that determines the object mobile. But what determines the knowledge of the mobile in your mind? This is the problem which those philosophers who concentrate on world of doing with the things always miss to explain correctly. What determines your thoughts? What determines your knowledge? So, but you know that all our knowledge is knowledge because it is determinate knowledge. What determines knowledge? Not the quality of the things. Qualities of things are outside. So, only language can determine the thoughts, can determine the knowledge. So, nothing but only language, that is intelligible being of the language, can determine the intelligible being of the objects. So, the language, that is intelligible being of the language, not only expresses itself, but it determines the meaning also. So a concept that is the that comprises the intelligible being of object and the intelligible being of meaning are determined because of only language. So all knowledge is infused by language. Can we think about any thought? Can we think about any idea? Can we imagine about any idea without thought? I think that your answer will be negative. No thought, no perception, nothing can be. So even this cannot be known as mobile if the word mobile is not used. It can be anything. But you can say that I do not know. But it is a mobile because the word mobile is there. Maybe that mobile is, there is no mobile backside, only this outer side is there, you are perceiving. How can you say mobile? Unless the word mobile flashes in your mind. only then the meaning mobile is expressed by that flesh. So there is no third link is required. Now, some philosophers are there, some systems are in Indian philosophy and Western philosophy are there, who accept two types of knowledge. The first, knowledge means you can say thought. The first is determinate thought and indeterminate thought. So they differ from us because they say that, oh, there is indeterminate thoughts also, indeterminate knowledge also. For example, the Nayayikas, Nayayikas, Bodhas, they say that no, our mind cannot know the indeterminate knowledge. And what it knows is only vikalpa. That is produced by the mind. So mental production, mental construction. Likewise, Nayayikas also say that there are, at first level, there are indeterminate knowledge, and then that same knowledge becomes determinate. So determinate is subordinated to indeterminate. But for us, the language philosophers, all knowledge is determinate because language determinates it. So unless language does not determinate, there will be no knowledge. So our position is either there is no knowledge or there is determinate knowledge. Even the indeterminate is also determinated by the word indeterminate. And you are using the term indeterminate. Why? To determinate the knowledge of the indeterminate. So indeterminate is also determinate knowledge of the indeterminate. Even non-existence, you know, vriksho nasti, the tree does not exist. This also flashes in the mind, and therefore we know that independently of there is tree. So negative sentences, most of the time we use negative sentences, more than affirmative sentences. All flashes in my mind, and therefore the intelligible thing of negative being, intelligible being of negation, intelligible being of indeterminate, they are also known by language. And so it is because the language determinates them so, as negation, as affirmation, as indeterminate, as determinate. So there is all determinate knowledge if there is knowledge. Otherwise, there is the world of meditation which philosophers does not occupy. Philosophers occupy only with the determinate knowledge that is expressed by the language. So if you are talking about something knowledge, mysterious, above the determinate knowledge, that for philosophy is of no use. So now, some problem arises, how I think about the language when I talk in the context of East and West, what problems? We know determinate knowledge is identical knowledge of language, of meaning by language. So identical cognition of any object in its any word, in its different occurrences and instances, cannot be expressed in your mind if there is no language. How can you know that the word cow means cowness? So in all its uses, different uses, the word cow, the word man denotes, expresses cowness, man, manness. How this identical cognition, that when you say Professor Tiwari, stop, so immediately a meaning flashes in my mind. So I have been asked to stop. This identical cognizance in all the times, you, Professor Kanti, Professor Satyadharan, or any say that Professor Tiwari, stop. Identical cognition is expressed in my mind by the language itself. If language is transcendental to thought, there will be no possibility of identical cognition, because of being the thought transcendental to language. So the first and the foremost problem is to explain the identical cognition by the language. That we have to accept that there is a status of, there is a position of language as intelligible being. In Sanskrit we say madhyama sabda. Bhartiyari says spot. Spot is the flash. It is not a metaphysical thing. It is not a metaphorical entity. It is a flash of the mind. That is cognitive being. Cognitive being. It directly flashes in your mind. You cannot deny. You cannot deny your own flashes. To deny the flashes of your own is to deny that you are a self-conscious being. So this is the position which I understand. You may differ. And it will be a good dialogue between us. Let us see. The second problem is that and very cleverly, the metaphysicians deviate us from the true position of the knowledge. That is, okay, language is metaphorical, and there is question of validity of knowledge by language. Oh, air will come and he will say, all descriptive sentences, all moral sentences, they all are meaningless. Okay, na? All the sentences, all the words, he may say propositions, that does not refer to anything outside in the empirical world, is meaningless. Only those words or sentences are meaningful whose verification is possible in correspondence with the experience. So if I say that there is cow and there is outside a cow and there is a correspondence between this sentence and the object cow outside, only then it is valid. Otherwise, only then it is a sentence. Otherwise, it may be grammatically a sentence, but it is meaningless. So he has a conception of his own meaning. And this conception of meaning has dominated the West. Even Wittgenstein has not come out of this problem. But the thing is that if we believe that, or if we concentrate on the knowledge that is expressed by language, then even imagination, or you say Rahu, Sira, or Akash, Kusumi, Sky, Pusp, they are also language, words, and they express meaning. And that's why we know that Akash Kusum is such a thing that does not exist in the empirical world. But we know the meaning. Do we not know the meaning? If we will not know the meaning of the sky flower, then we will ask what? But we never ask when the sky flower is said to us, because we know the meaning. And if we know the meaning, this means that meaning is verity, veridical. Now about the validity, the veridical cognition, even imagination, imaginary cognition, negation, all expresses veridical cognition of their own. So all sentences express the veridical, even contradiction. Contradictory sentences, they also express their own meaning, contradiction. Otherwise, we will not know. So language is expression, and what it expresses, whether it is imagery, false, negation, and all that, we know that it is because that is veridical cognition. Now the problem of verification comes. So you may have a different criteria of verification, another may have different criteria of falsification, testification, and so many things. So AR and others, they have their own criterions of falsification. And but the thing is that if the basic veridical knowledge expressed in the mind is there, that is verified or falsified on the basis of absence or presence of the things in correspondence. So how can we negate the verity of the cognition expressed beforehand in the mind that is serving as the basis of our logical verification into validity and invalidity? This is the basic thing. So we have to accept that what is expressed in the mind by language is veridical. Even non-veridical is also expressed by language. That's why we know this, that is also veridical. So far validity and invalidity is concerned, that is based on our experience with the things outside. And therefore, outside things, if they are present there, we say that the sentence is valid. If these things in correspondence are not existing there, we say that no, it is invalid. Like that. Now, what I want to say? I want to say that if language and thought are different, even validity, invalidity, this device will not work. So language and thought are not different. How they are not different, now I will discuss about that. If I have time, only 10 to 20 minutes more. Am I having?
Yeah, you have time, sir.
Okay. So another problem is there. We analyze language, and language is in our hand. And we say, we are Western philosopher, we are Nayayikas, we are Baudh and all that. We say that by analyzing the language, we analyze the meaning. If the meaning is transcendental to language, how can the language analysis be the analysis of the meaning? If the meaning is transcendental, this is also a very baffling problem, very difficult problem to solve in philosophy of language. Translation. So suppose Professor Pandey has written some text and I am going to translate it. But unless what he has written, the text is not expressed in my mind, it does not become the object of my knowledge, how can I translate? Suppose I know two languages, Devam Jalam Barsati, Pani Baras Raha Hai. I know, therefore, I can translate into the languages of my proximity. If I know Chinese, I can translate it also. But if something I do not know, how can I translate it into different? This means thought and language, both are not different. Language is also thought. It is also intelligible being. And the meaning is also thought. And our knowledge is limited only to these intelligible beings. We do with the things outside, but we know with the objects that is intelligible being, that places in our mind. So the word of doing and the word of knowing. We, the philosophy student philosophers, we are concerned only with the world of knowing. And the word of knowing is the word of the language and the meaning. That is intelligible objects, intelligible beings. And the relation between the two, I can say that it is the fitness of the intelligible being of language that it expresses naturally the intelligible being of meaning. So, if this is so, only then, if I analyze language, that analysis will be at the same time the analysis of the meaning as well. But if the meaning is transcendental to language, no analysis will start. And if it is possible that I can still analyze, that analysis will be not philosophy. Philosophy concerned with the knowledge. with the awareness, what you directly know, you are analyzing that. You analyzing your own phrases. So if something I am knowing, I can analyze it. And by that analysis of the language, the meaning is also analyzed at the same time, because meaning and language are non-different. But if the meaning is transcendental to language, I cannot translate, I cannot analyze, I cannot translate the meaning by language being transcendental. Now, these are the two problems. And other problems are there, but I know that here I have a very short time. Within a few minutes, I have to express all the views. So, we often discuss about the thoughts and language. You know, I will take, I do not know much about the Wittgenstein, just I want to understand him, but still I do not understand. But he said that, yes, there is a word and there is a language. Language is, in fact, what we speak or write. And you know, Austin will give importance, primacy to only written, not the word, but well, not the vocal. But we believe in both. Wittgenstein will also not deny the existence of both. So we will say that, okay, there is language and there is word. He conceptualizes a world reference, world representation, world representation. So this representation is the linking meaning of the language we speak and the world outside. But that is all a constructed idea. And by that constructed idea, the language, which is very temporary, more in comparison to it, the word outside is more permanent. The word outside is material given there, and the language we speak are just immersed when we speak it. So many things, form of life and others, he accepted to interpret only the relation between the language and thought. Language and thought, language and meaning. But I think that is too much conceptualization, which Wittgenstein can only do. But in our tradition, we believe that, Patanjali says in Mahavasya, he was asked, what is the word, what is the shabda word, when we say gau? See, what is the word gau, when we utter the word gau? Gauri tika shabda. And the answer, you know what he said? Tasna langul kakur khura bishani nam sampratyayo bhavati sa shabda. Sampratyatmaka shabda. That by listening which the concept cow is flashed, that is word cow. So the word cow is what flashes when we listen the utterances cow. So he makes a difference between the dhvaniya and the shabda. Shabda is that which is fit to express its meaning non-differently. Independently of anything, our mind or anything, language is a power. It is a power, and that can produce the utterances also. Language is power, and meaning is also power, but they are not external power. They are intelligible powers, and the two powers are not different, because the language power expresses the meaning power. What it expresses is meaning, and it expresses itself is language. So language is not confined to what we speak. It is thought. It is intelligible object. And when we take the language and meaning as language and thought as intelligible object, our philosophical reflections becomes becomes easy to understand and explain. That language and analysis and translation becomes understandable, how we analyze, how we translate meaning by language. Even the analysis of language by language is possible because language is intelligible being, and the language is speak is only instrumental. So by the instrumental, we know the intelligible being of language, and this intelligible being of language is produces the verbal noises or written marks. So other problems are also there. People used to say that what is the original in between the written marks, lipya and dhvaniya. So you know, many philosophers of the West, in East also, Nayayikas, Shabda Anitya, Shabda Anitya, Vedantins, also they will say, but the thing is that they accept the eternity of the Veda, but they accept that Shabda Anitya, Anitya, Shabda is not eternal, Shabda is passing, that is transient. But they accept the Veda as eternal, Aparushya. How is it possible? If Shabda is not eternal, Ved, what is Ved? Is it only thought without language? No, it is language and thought at the same time. So if you have to believe in the authority of the Ved, you have to accept the eternity of the language. I'm right, na? So now you see, again, a question in the dreams and similar situations. We dreamed so many things, but there is no language. Language, that is what we speak. Then how we know that there is elephant in the dream, and the elephant, I am being chased by the elephant, and I am sweating just like to save my life and all that. How it is possible in the dreams? It is because of the language as thought. Had there been no language as thought, there will be no dreams. So even the dream consciousness is the consciousness in language. So I established that language and thought are non-different. Language is also. All words are concepts, and concepts are the thought of the language, and the thought of meaning expressed by the language. With these words, I think that I finish. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for presenting a very thought-provoking lecture, sir. It was very thought-provoking. It has many ideas to discuss hereafter. We cannot discuss everything, but a few questions I think we can take up for our reflection. And I have many questions in my mind, but then I myself restrict myself that I should give opportunity to others. But only one question, I cannot stop resisting myself, that you are such a knowledgeable person of both Bhaktivedanta and Wittgenstein, sir. So will it be like, okay, if I ask one question, and that is, what do you find similarity between Wittgenstein and Bhaktivedanta? One single similarity between Wittgenstein and Bhaktivedanta, like in philosophy of language, any one single similarity if you say, then it will be beneficial to many of us, which bring Wittgenstein close to Bhaktivedanta.
Sir, I will make a distinction between Wittgenstein later and the earlier. And I will be easy to make your point clear with the earlier Wittgenstein and her theory. And then I will come to later. So the first you see, you know, so many big things, big statements are there in Tractatus. My word is the word of language, words, and like that. Very good. But the thing is that he always maintains that thought is different from thought is effect. Language is also effect, and effect is any experience is effect. So if the language is effect and thought is effect, what will be relation between the two facts? The first question. Bhartrihari very nicely counters it and he says that yes, it may be effect and language is effect and meaning is effect. Sir, 1 minute I will take, then coming. Just to open the door and then.
All right.
Okay. It is open by someone. So he can say that the relation between the two is commonness. But we do not accept that anything, there is anything common in between two uses or in between two facts. All facts are individual, particular. The fact of language can never be the fact of meaning, fact of thought. So if we say that there is similarity between the use of the language and the meaning, some similarity, what sort of similarity that be? That is very difficult to determine in the context of the Tractatus. But what sort of similarity will be there? Similarity of uses. So, but similarity of uses does not say anything about the similarity of two facts. The similarity of the two uses, that is different fact. A similarity of the language effect and meaning effect, that is different. So when we talk about the similarity between the language and meaning, we cannot make excuse by shifting it to the similarity of two occurrences of the same sentence. So another thing is that Wittgenstein said that in investigations, meaning is used and language is dead if it has no meaning. Language gets meaning only when it is attached with a language gets life only when it is attached with a meaning. So this means he always accepts that meaning is something more significant, though his move in the linguistic analysis was that he is going to give importance to language more than the meaning. But the thing is that when he says that language gets meaning only when it is attached with some, when language gets life only when it is attached with some meaning, this means he is giving more importance to meaning. But here Bhartrihari gives more importance to language. Language expresses meaning. Meaning does not exist if there is no language. So isolated from language, there is no thought. So all thought is thought infused with language, in language and through language. So this is Bhartrihari's position. But sometimes I found difficult to understand the same thing in Wittgenstein, because he said that yes, there is language, very important thing, very essential thing. No, but the thing is that it is dead unless it is attached with some meaning. This means he is giving importance to meaning and secondary or subordinate position to the language. And then in between the two, he conceptualized a third thing and like that. So, but Bhartrihari does not feel any mediator or link between the language and the thought. And he says that language is naturally fit to express the meaning as if our eyes are naturally fit to perceive the object's rupa, form, and color, and the ears are naturally fit to listen the dhvaniya, and our nose are naturally fit to smell the smells. Likewise, language is naturally fit to express the meaning. So This natural fitness is the link between the natural fitness of the expressor, is the link between the expressor and the express. So there is no need of a third or a medium or a link between the language, and there is no need of conceptualization also, like world representation and language representation, thought representation, and all that. This is what I understand. I've written a chapter, but that is only to agitate the Wittgensteinians. But I have not got it published.
Very nice, sir. Very nice.
First, I want to give it to you for your comments, and then I will think about it.
Okay, sir. Nice. Very nice. So there is Professor Geeta Manaktala from Chandigarh. Geeta Manaktala.
Yeah. Fine.
So she is asking.
My number to her.
Yeah, she is asking a simple question. Madam Manaktala, ma'am, please ask your question. In fact, she has asked question that is it necessary for a sentence to be meaningful that it must refer to something existing outside?
Nice, nice. So thank you, madam, for this question. It's very important in this lecture. See, actually, reference theory, you know, it is already failed in the West. So for them, any sentence is meaningful only if it refers to something. But the problem is, a whole sentence does not refer a thing only. It can refer an action. Suppose I say, Dr. Pandey is there. So there, this is not just like a proper noun or noun, a thing. So only things can be referred. But when I say you exist there, you are there, this is like, there is a verb. So no sentences, even I can say that no sentence denotes a fact like proper noun or pronoun. All sentences convey words. So this is the problem with the verification theorists who accept that reference. How can I refer Pandey, Dr. Pandey is there, Professor Pandey is there. I can refer Professor